to keep me from falling off the platform. Welcome and good morning. Welcome to Fellowship Bible Church. Those of you that are here and those of you who are faithful and online, we appreciate you tuning in every Sunday. And thank you, Praise Team. They did a good job with having a couple of key members out of town this weekend. And it's really exciting to have Sharon here. Sharon, we get to see you from time to time and to help out with you purchasing a new car. And then I also wanted to mention that Mark Smith is left yesterday for Honduras. So as you pray for our missionaries, he is doing a water project in Honduras. Remember him during that time. Susan, on the other hand, is on a cruise. Yeah, she took the easy way out. But I also wanted to mention that we have George Lyman with us today. George, stand up a moment. George is with the Gideons. You want to say a quick word?
Oh, just wanted to say hello and thanks for your prayers. You're doing your work faithfully over here in Texas as well as U.S. internationally. So, thank you.
Thank you, George. Good to have you and your wife here today. And while they're here, I want to remind you that by our door, when you go out this door and then the exit door, there is a card rack that's out there that has Gideon cards in it. And from time to time, we point that out. But this is an opportunity for you to donate a Bible in somebody's name. And these cards are they're for every occasion. I just, two of them I grabbed here. One of them, you have made a difference in my life. And if somebody has done something special for you, then you can just fill this out and the card will be sent to them saying that a Bible was donated in their name. And here's one that says congrats to grads, I think. And they're just for every occasion, sickness and health and wedding and whatever. And so those cards are there. A Bible costs $5. And so if you put in $25, you can send 5 Bibles in a person's name, just as kind of an honor for them. I do that from time to time when somebody is sick or absent for a while. I send a Bible in their name just so that they know I've been thinking about them and praying for them. Would you turn with me in your Bibles to Colossians. There's only one Colossians. Colossians chapter 1. I'm going to concentrate on one particular verse this morning. But this is a controversial passage of Scripture for some, a confusing passage of Scripture for others, and a misinterpreted and misunderstood passage of Scripture for many, many others. In his book, Catholic scholar Peter Diamond addresses the question, did Jesus' suffering on the cross account for all of our sins? He writes in his book, Protestants like to think that Jesus Christ's passion and death made up for everything, including the penalty due to all future sins. Yes, I like to think that. There are no worries about something such as purgatory, they say, because Jesus Christ paid the price for it all. That's proven false by Colossians 1:24, he writes. He continues, quoting the verse, now I rejoice in my suffering for your sake, and in my flesh I am filling up what is lacking in the afflictions of Christ on behalf of his body, which is the church. He continues, Paul says that he fills up for the church those things that are wanting or lacking in the sufferings of Christ. Christ's suffering was perfect and of infinite value. So what does this mean, he asks. What Paul means is that many sufferings are still lacking and needed for the church to work out their salvation, which was all made possible by Christ's sacrifice. This verse proves that Christ's sacrifice doesn't do away with all worries about the possibility of future punishment due to one's sins. Well, this understanding of Colossians 1:24 opens the door, certainly for the teaching and doctrine of purgatory. In Catholic doctrine, purgatory is a state of temporary punishment or purification that souls go through after death to prepare themselves for heaven. Because according to them, all of your sins are not atoned for, you're not perfect, you're not prepared, you're not ready to step right into heaven. And so it's a final stage of sanctification that involves suffering, but it's not a place of eternal damnation, it's a temporary place. So purgatory is a place where souls who died in God's grace can make amends for their sins and become pure enough to enter into heaven. Is that what Paul is teaching here in Colossians 1:24? I do not believe that it is. But let me set that aside for a moment and ask a question. Why do we exist? Why does Fellowship Bible Church exist? Do you know how old Fellowship Bible Church is? How old? 40 years, 2 weeks ago. 2 weeks ago. The first Sunday of September was our 40th anniversary. And Randy, you weren't even coming then, were you?
No.
And Craigers, were you coming then? Not quite, okay? And we have a new man back here, a visitor today, who actually grew up in this church. And you weren't attending 40 years ago either, I don't think. Okay. Well, welcome back, okay? Welcome back. Why do we exist? Why have we spent over 40 years as a church in this community? Why have we spent so much time and energy and money? We need to be able to answer the question, I believe, because it's not enough to simply say that we exist for the sake of our existence. Well, we've just always been for 40 years, and that's what we do. No, the answer to the question is it helps it to answer the question, I think. It helps to look at the words of a man who was very clear about what he did and why he did what he did. I'm talking about the Apostle Paul. There's never been anyone like him, not in all the history of the church. He originally opposed Christianity before becoming its greatest messenger. He traveled across the Roman world to spread the gospel message to everyone that would hear. Scholars estimate that Paul traveled about 10,000 miles by foot. 10,000 miles. I can't even imagine what that is, except I looked it up, and it's kind of like walking, if you could, from the U.S.-Canadian border to the tip of the South Pole, right to the pole. 10,000 miles. He's been called the greatest missionary who ever lived as he traveled through Israel, Syria, Turkey, Greece, and Italy. He started at least 14 churches. He also wrote 28% of the New Testament. Why did he do that? Paul will answer today by telling us what his ministry was all about in this passage. And it will help us understand what we're all about too, what we do. So here in one sentence is why Paul existed and why we exist too. He says, "Now I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake. And in my flesh I am filling up what is lacking in Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, that is the church." Everybody understand? Let me close in prayer. No, not yet. This is one of those sentences that really confuses us. If I hadn't read it in the Bible, I wouldn't dare stand up and say it. Yet I think it's one of the most profound ideas to understand because it communicates so well why the church of Jesus Christ exists. Let me put it in one sentence. We exist to do what hasn't already been done by Jesus through his sufferings. I'll unpack that for you. Through his sacrificial death, Jesus has done everything necessary to provide salvation for sinners. Jesus, through his sacrificial death, did everything you need for your complete and absolute salvation, and there is nothing missing. Everything. This is good news that we proclaim every week. Jesus has died for our sins and nothing more needs to be done. When Jesus died on the cross, he bore all of our sins. He paid the entire price of our salvation. I grew up singing a hymn that says, "My sin, oh the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross. I bear it no more. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul." Jesus has removed the wrath of God from his people, from us. He has finished striking Satan with a death blow. He has established the new covenant for his people. "It is finished," Jesus said on the cross. There is nothing more that needs to be done for salvation. There is nothing more that needs to be done for me to enter into heaven or for you to enter heaven. Jesus has done it all. The work has been completed. Okay, so if through his sacrificial death, Jesus has done everything necessary to provide salvation to sinners, what does Paul mean when he says that he's filling up that which is lacking? That gets to the very heart of the issue of why we exist And here's the answer. Although Jesus has done everything necessary to provide salvation for sinners, there is one thing left to do: to carry the news of what Jesus has done to the people who have never heard it, to carry the news of what Jesus has done to the world that is lost and dying in their sins. Jesus has paid it all, but the message is not done. The message is not complete. Would you stand together with me for our scripture reading, Colossians 1, 24 to 29. And I read, "Now I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake, and I fill up what is lacking of Christ's afflictions in my flesh on behalf of his body, which is the church, of which I was made a minister according to the stewardship from God given to me for you, so that I might fully carry out the preaching of the word of God. That is the mystery which has been hidden from the past ages and generations, but has now been manifested to his saints, to whom God willed to make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory." I got to tell you that those are seven of the greatest words in all of the world. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Come next week and I'm going to talk about those. Verse 28, "Him we proclaim, admonishing every man and teaching every man with all wisdom, so that we may present every man complete in Christ. For this purpose, I also labor, striving according to his working, which he works in me in power." Lord God, I pray that the Holy Spirit would descend upon this place, this sanctuary today. Lord God, I pray that you would be our teacher today, be our speaker, be the one who ministers to our hearts and our souls. And show us, Lord, that while the work of our salvation is done, the work of evangelization is not done, and there is much more to be done. And may we be busy, may we be active, may we be participants and not just observers in the work of Jesus Christ. Lord, you've called your church to be active, to have an active membership, to get in there, to get into the fight, to get into the battle, to strive, to labor for the cause of Jesus Christ. Lord God, I pray, speak to us. Show us the truth of your word today. May we apply it to our lives in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. So I'm going to give you 3 points this morning, I think. 3 points. And you got to forgive me a little bit because they seem kind of negative. As I was looking over my sermon beforehand, I'm going to talk about the misery of proclaiming Jesus. Wow, what a downer that is, huh? It seems like I should be talking about the excitement of proclaiming Jesus, not the misery of proclaiming Jesus, except that Paul is really taking us in that direction in this passage of Scripture. Proclaiming Jesus has always meant physical suffering for believers around the world and throughout the ages. There are thousands of people every year, even in modern times, that are martyred for the cause of Christ. They are doing the work of evangelism. They are living the life of Jesus Christ. They are doing the work of the church, but they suffer for the work that they do. Isaac Watts wrote a hymn, "Am I a Soldier of the Cross?" Some of you remember singing that when you were younger. And the words say, "Must I be carried to the skies on flowery beds of ease while others fought to win the prize and sailed through bloody seas?" He's talking about, wow, it's easy for me where I live. He was from England. And England and the United States has known very little suffering for the cause of Christ. And yet we send out missionaries to parts of the world. Some of them die. Some of them become very sick. Some of them are persecuted. Some of them are injured in so many different ways. And they sail through bloody seas while it's ease for the rest of us. Isaac Watts said, is that right? Is that fair? Paul's sufferings, he said, the sufferings in my flesh resulted in my rejoicing. Do you see that right at the beginning of verse 24? I rejoice. I rejoice. Now, it seems kind of crazy to me to rejoice in suffering. But Paul realized that he was suffering for a reason. Now I rejoice. The now in the Greek is emphatic. It means now I rejoice. Where is he when he's writing this? He's in prison. He's in bonds. He's in chains. He has guards with him at all times. And Paul says, now I rejoice. Right here in prison, I rejoice. under these circumstances, I rejoice. What was Paul's source of joy? What was he talking about? He was completing that which was lacking in the sufferings of Jesus. Now, hold on to that thought just for a moment, if you would. I'll come back to it. Paul was destined to suffer right from the very beginning of his call on the road to Damascus. Do you remember that? Paul was on the road to Damascus. He was heading up north to Damascus, where he was going to hunt down, capture, arrest, and send Christians back to Jerusalem for trial. And while he's on the road, he has an encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ. And he is struck blind so that he has to be led into Damascus. And in Damascus, God speaks to Ananias, a Jewish believer there. And God speaks to Ananias and says, "Go, for he, Paul, is a chosen instrument of mine to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the sons of Israel. For I will show him how much he must suffer in my name." That's from the very onset. From Paul's salvation on the road to Damascus, God speaks to Ananias and says, "This man will suffer, and he will suffer much in my name." I don't have time to take you this morning to the passage of Scripture where Paul lays out all of his sufferings, but Paul suffered in every way imaginable. He suffered beatings. He suffered from stoning. He suffered from being shipwrecked. He suffered in every way imaginable. Even in sickness, he suffered because of his dedication to the work of Jesus Christ. And now in Colossians 1:24, Paul says, "Now I fill up what is lacking of Christ's afflictions in my flesh." Now we have to be careful with this verse. I want to remind you of something that I talked about last week. Analogia scriptura. It's a Latin phrase, and it's a phrase that applies to hermeneutics, which is the interpretation of the Bible. Analogia scriptura basically says that when you are analyzing Scripture, that's the word there. When you are analyzing Scripture, you must understand that no Scripture stands alone, or no Scripture can be interpreted in contradiction to what the rest of the Bible is teaching us. And so the Bible teaches us that the sufferings that Jesus performed on our behalf for our eternal salvation are complete. The Bible teaches that all over. I'm going to show you that. So this is not, when Paul says, I'm filling up what is lacking in Christ's sufferings, it's not a lack of payment for sin, because it is paid in full. On the cross, Jesus said, tetelestai, called that out. It is paid in full. It's not a lack of sufficiency in the work of Christ. He made sufficient propitiation. Now, I know propitiation is a big word. Propitiation means that the Father is satisfied. He fully satisfied the Father. It's not an add-on to Jesus' words, "It is finished," because finished means finished, okay? It's as simple as that. Finished means finished. What does the Bible say about the work of Christ? Well, let me give you three key verses. All of them I find in Hebrews, all together in Hebrews. Number one, Hebrews 10:10. We have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. We've been made holy, holy, through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. One time, Jesus died, Jesus suffered, Jesus made payment, and we are made holy. Now, I want you to understand that holy is an all or nothing. You can't be part holy. You can't be a little bit holy. Holy doesn't work that way. I always like to use this example. If I take a barrel of sewage and I add a spoonful of wine, what do I have? Sewage. If I take a barrel of wine and I add a spoonful of sewage, what do I have? Sewage. I still have sewage. I'm not drinking that. Nobody's drinking that, okay? Holy is an all or nothing. Pure is an all or nothing. Forgiven is an all or nothing. It's positional. We are positional. Now, that doesn't mean that we are practically holy in all of our life, because we still sin, don't we? We're still subject to sin, but we are made holy because the holiness of God is imputed to us through his Son, Jesus Christ. We have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body. The second verse is found four verses later, in Hebrews 10:14, "For by one sacrifice, he has made perfect forever those who are being made holy. Now, holy is an all or nothing. Perfect is an all or nothing. And perfect is a positional perfection in Christ Jesus. Again, I am still subject to sin, but God sees me and all that I am through the blood, covered by the blood of Jesus. By one sacrifice, he made me and you perfect. And everyone who is being made holy is perfect through the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, right in between those two verses is Hebrews 10:12. Now, verse 11 says, day after day, every priest stands and performs his religious duties. The writer to Hebrews is talking about in Old Testament times at the temple that the priest, or even at the tabernacle before the temple was built, the priest was constantly performing his duties, night and day. The tabernacle did not shut down. The temple did not shut down. There were priests that worked in the day and priests that worked at night 24 days a week, 360 days a year. You say, well, what about the others? Well, they only had 360 days in the ancient calendar, okay? So 360 days, every day, all day, the priest was there doing his job. And then the writer to the Hebrews writes in verse 12, but when this priest, Jesus, when our priest, Jesus, when the ultimate high priest, Jesus, had offered for all time one sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God. Sitting down is symbolic of the work being done. So we're told we're made holy through the sacrifice of Jesus. We are made perfect through the sacrifice of Jesus. And when Jesus was finished with his sufferings, he sat down at the right hand of God. Now, Paul's suffering is not, Paul's suffering is not to secure his salvation, but rather it's to spread the message of salvation. Jesus provides, we proclaim. Jesus provides salvation, we proclaim the salvation that Jesus has done. The salvific work was completed on the cross. It is done, it is finished. But the preaching of the message was not done. Hadn't even really begun yet. The sacrifice was made. Now the good news needs to be shouted to the whole world. The devil does whatever he can do to prevent the gospel from being proclaimed. Do you understand that? The devil will do everything he can to keep the gospel from being proclaimed. The devil has all kinds of schemes, all kinds of tricks, all kinds of things that he's up to, and he'll do whatever he can. And that means causing Christians who spread the word of Jesus Christ to suffer in every way imaginable. Jesus is present in his body, the church. Next week we're going to look at Christ in you, the hope of glory. Jesus Christ dwells in his people. Jesus Christ dwells in the body of the church. We are the body of the church. Jesus is present in his body, the church. We are his messengers. And what is lacking is the proclamation of the gospel. That's why we exist, folks. That's what we're all about. That's why we're here. That's what Fellowship Bible Church has been doing for the last 40 years. The church is involved in a spiritual war. And that's why I guess I used the heading, the misery of proclaiming Jesus. It's war. It's war. Satan is the god of this world. We're living on his turf. We're living on his land. He'll do anything to defeat the cause of Christ. Satan is at work all around us, and we see that. We see it in the news. We see it in politics. We see it in government. We see it in our school systems. We see it in every aspect of life. Satan is at work to defeat the cause of Christ. Satan attacked Christ in every way imaginable when Christ was physically living on earth. From the beginning of Jesus' ministry until the end, even on the cross, Satan was tempting him to do wrong. Satan was tempting Jesus to violate the word of God. Do you remember? You remember when Jesus went into the wilderness and Satan came with his temptations in the wilderness? And they continued all the way through. There's one point where Peter actually says something, because sometimes believers actually listen to the devil and do the work of the devil. And Jesus looked at Peter and said, "Get thee behind me, Satan." And then when Jesus was on the cross, there was two malefactors, one on either side. And one of them looked at him and said, if you're really the Christ, save yourself and us. Temptations from the beginning until the end. But he's not done yet. Satan isn't done yet. His attack on the church is still an attack on Christ. When Satan attacks me, when Satan attacks you, when Satan attacks the church, whether it's fellowship or every church in the world, Satan is attacking the body of Jesus Christ because Christ dwells within us. And Paul is suffering on behalf of his body, Jesus' body, which is the church. Remember what Jesus said to Saul on the road to Damascus? Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? He didn't say, why are you persecuting Christians? He said, why are you persecuting me? Because Satan's attack against Jesus in us involves human flesh. Therefore, when Paul writes, now I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake, and I fill up what is lacking of Christ's afflictions in my flesh on behalf of his body, which is the church. Paul is not saying that Jesus failed to complete anything. He's not saying that there is any part of our salvation that needs to be provided yet. He's not saying that there's anything that falls short in us being forgiven and washed clean. Paul is not saying that additional payment has to be made. Paul is saying two things. Number one, what is lacking is the evangelization of the gospel by the body of Christ, which is the church. And that has been the duty and responsibility and ministry and mission of the church for 2,000 years. And secondly, Paul is saying Satan will attack the body of Christ, causing it, the church, to suffer in fulfilling the cause of Christ. Why do we suffer? Why do we suffer? Why are we attacked by the enemy? Why do we find ourselves in the middle of spiritual warfare? Because Satan is attacking Jesus, and Jesus is in us. Jesus is in us. So that takes me to the second thing in verse 25, the ministry of proclaiming Jesus. Paul's ministry was characterized by two things. I want to focus your attention on this verse. And he says in verse 25, of which I was made a minister according to the stewardship from God given to me for you, so that I might fully carry out the preaching of the word of God. He uses two words there. I was made a minister according to the stewardship. Verse 23 and 25, both of those verses, Paul calls himself a minister. Diakonos, from which we get our English word deacon, or one who executes the commands of another. Deacon, diakonos, is the servant of a king, a waiter, one who serves food and drink. Paul says, I'm a servant. I'm a minister. And then he says, I'm a steward, according to the stewardship from God. Stewardship is the management of a household or household affairs. A steward in ancient times was like the chief servant, the chief caretaker. For Abraham in the Old Testament, he had a chief servant whose name was Eliezer. He was in charge of the whole business. He was the chief operating officer. That's what a steward is, a servant, one who serves, a steward, one who serves in direct obedience to the master, to the owner, in carrying out the management of the household and the household affairs. Now, serving requires two things. It requires hearing, and it requires doing. Receiving instruction and obeying those instructions. If I'm an employee, and on my first day of work, my employer has told me, show up at 6 o'clock. And I get up and my wife says, what time are you supposed to be to work today? And I say, well, I don't know. He said 6, but I think I'm going to go in about 8. Okay, well, number one, I obviously did not listen to him. I heard him, but I didn't listen. And number two, I'm not obeying him. A servant is required to hear and do, to receive instruction and to obey. A steward requires faithful management. It's oikonomia. Oikonomia is the Greek word. It means to manage, to administrate, to have oversight. So the ministry of proclaiming Jesus involves serving Jesus and being a steward of Jesus. Thus, Paul is a servant according to the stewardship, number one, from God. Number two, given to me. Number three, for you. Like a table waiter. I really think of the ministry. I think of a pulpit ministry as being like a table waiter in a restaurant. I remember many, many years ago, I've lost track of how many years ago now, long before I was the pastor here and attended this church, Philip Ritchie called me one day. Some of you remember him. He was an elder in our church. He called me one day because Mark Smith was going to be gone, and he wanted to know if I could speak. And he invited me to bring the message on a coming Sunday, to which I agreed. But then he called me up closer to the fact, and he was checking on me just to see how it was going. He said, I know that there's a lot of effort, there's a lot of stress, there's a lot of preparation, there's a lot of everything that goes into preparing this, and I just wanted to see how you were doing. And I remember saying to him, Philip, I got to tell you something. Yeah, there is. But I said, you need to understand, Jesus prepared the meal. The people are hungry. And my job is to carry the meal from the cook Jesus and put it on the table before the people. That's all I am, folks. That's all I am. I'm a table waiter for Jesus. That's what being a Christian is all about, a table waiter for Jesus. When you have an opportunity to witness to somebody, what are you doing? You're taking the meal God prepared and putting it on the table in front of the people. You're just the in-between guy. My job is to try to get it to you from God to you, to your table, without dropping it on the floor. I'm just bringing you what God has said. Paul's ministry had a single focus, so that I might fully carry out the preaching of the word of God. That's what it says in the King James. That's what it says in the Legacy Standard Bible. Many of your Bibles have something very similar to that. So that I might fully carry out the preaching of the word of God. But you know what? The word, the preaching of, is not in the Greek. That's just put in there to make it a little bit easier to understand. In the Greek, and the King James Version does a very good job on this, and the New King James, it says to fulfill the word of God. So that I might fully fulfill the word of God. That's what it says. That's Paul's ministry, just to fully carry out, to live the word of God. In today's business, maybe where you work, we have what is known as a KPI. I don't know if you ever heard of that. Key performance indicators. How do you know if you're doing the job right? Well, your employer may have key performance indicators for you. KPIs are the key targets you should track to make the most impact of your expected business outcomes. What are the things that you're supposed to be doing to get to where you want to be? Well, a KPI example for an educational service might be student-teacher ratio. It might be student retention, graduation rates, student satisfaction. If I'm doing my job, I'm hanging on to students, and they're graduating, and they're satisfied, and maybe even getting a job. That's a KPI. A church can use key performance indicators to measure its success and progress. KPIs are custom baselines that are specific to a church's mission, vision, and purpose. They can help churches determine if they are on the right track and how well they are meeting their goals. What's my KPI? What is your KPI? Your job as a Christian is to present, proclaim, dispense, make known the word of God. That's all. That's all. Fully carry out the preaching. Literally, make the word known. How do you make the word known? By living the word. By living the word. That's all Jesus asks us to do. Live the word. Live the word. Make it known. Broadcast it. So verse 25, so that I might fully carry out the preaching of the word of God. The Legacy Standard Bible, in the Greek, there's only three words in the Greek. Plerao, Logos, Theos. Carry out the word of God. That's the whole verse. Abound in the word of God. Just abound in the word of God. Be saturated in the word of God. Be bathed in the word of God. Be covered in the word of God. Be smothered in the word of God. Just let the word of God abound in your life. The wonder of our, as Christians, key performance indicators is its ease. I've had some jobs where when I looked at the key performance indicators, I couldn't even always understand what they were talking about. But when I look at the key performance indicators for being a believer, for being a Christian, folks, for being a membership of Fellowship Bible Church or the Church of Jesus Christ, I realize it's easy. It's easy. That's why Jesus said, take my yoke upon you. My yoke is easy. My burden is light. Read God's word and make it known. That's your KPI. That's all I do in sermon preparation. Read God's word and tell you what God said. I just read the word and then I say, this is what God says. And I show it to you in the Bible. I don't have to come up with theory. I don't have to come up with philosophy. I don't have to come up, invent new things, new strategies. I don't have to develop new products. I don't have to market new products. I just read the word of God and make it known. That's the job of a believer. So how do I meet my KPI goals? I read the word. I pray over the word. I memorize parts of the word. I live out what I read. And I share what I read. I live the word of God. And I share what I read. See, you know, here's the thing. Every one of you is already an expert at your KPI. You're already an expert at it. And I know that just from listening to your conversations before and after church. Or during the week. Because you tell me about a great movie that Joey and I just have to go and see. And you tell me all about it. This morning, I won't mention your name, Dave Williams. Whoops. Dave just got back from the Museum of the Bible in Washington, D.C., owned by the Greens. And he told me not all about it, but he told me much about it. Now, did you have to rehearse that? Did you sit down and memorize a script? Did you have to study that? Or did you just tell me what you knew? You just walked in, sat down next to me, and told me what you knew. See, we're an expert at it. We do it every day. We do it with movies. We do it with books. We do it with articles. We do it with TVs. We do it with museums. We do it with programs, newscasts, everything, anything that we have heard. We're pretty good at hanging on to that and relating it to another person. That's your KPI as a believer. That's all that Jesus is asking you to do. Your KPI, your economia, is just to be a good servant and steward by making the word of God known through how you live. Abound, abound, abound in the word. The last thing I want to talk about is the metal of proclaiming Jesus. Where do I get the strength? Where do I get the strength? The Christian walk involves suffering. The Christian work is stewardship. But the Christian way is war. It's war. Look at two words found in verse 29. It says, for this purpose, verse 29, I also labor, striving according to his workings, which he works in me in power. Labor and striving, two interesting words in the Greek. Kapiao is the Greek word for labor. It means to grow weary. Tired, exhausted. Really, the work of being a believer involves labor, weariness, tiredness, exhaustion. Why is it so hard? Well, the second word there, striving, do you see an English word in that Greek word? Agony. Agony. Agonizomaia. agony is in there. To contend with adversaries, to fight, to struggle with difficulties and dangers. While I'm laboring, I'm growing weary because I'm contending with adversaries. I am fighting, I'm struggling. Now, our adversaries, the Bible tells us, our adversaries are not flesh and blood. They're not other people. They're not people who disagree with us. That's not where our battle is. Our battle is with the powers and principalities of evil. Our battle is with Satan and his forces. So we are involved in a war. How do I get the strength for all this? Well, understand how intense this war is. Every time you open your Bible, I want you to know something. The enemy attacks. You ever sit down and just try to read a chapter in the Bible? And then you find your mind going off in all different directions about what you're making for dinner tonight or what you got to do when you get to work, or I got to remember to buy gas, or I got to remember to whatever. Whatever. Every time you open your Bible, the enemy will attack you. Every time you pray, the enemy will distract you. He'll attack you. And so you're praying. I like to pray out loud when I'm alone, if I'm alone. It always kind of embarrasses me if I'm praying out loud and somebody walks in on me. But I like to pray out loud because I'm less distracted when I'm praying out loud. Because I know that the enemy is going to attack me when I'm talking to my Father. By the way, I want you to know something. I know you know this. But we're on a first name basis with our Father. His name is Yahweh. Yahweh God. Is that cool? We get to call our Father by his first name. When you pray, the enemy attacks. When you worship, even when you worship at church, the enemy attacks. When you witness, the enemy will attack. A while ago, I had an opportunity to share Christ with a man. He had talked to me, and I could tell that he really was interested in knowing what it meant to be a Christian and to be saved. And so I set up a time when I could go to his house one evening. And I got there, and he was so open to the gospel. I've never seen a person more open, just hanging on every word I shared with him. Well, it wasn't long, and he had a little baby, and the baby just was crying and crying and crying as loud as it could. It wasn't a little baby, it was a toddler, and it could cry loud. And the man's wife didn't seem to mind it, and my wife picked up the little one and took him into another room and began singing in its ear. And pretty soon, the child was quiet. And I was right to the point where I was asking the man, would you like to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? And his wife jumped up, who said she was a believer, jumped up and said, I got some stuff for us to eat and some stuff for us to drink. And who wants this and who wants that? And interrupted me. And it destroyed the moment. It destroyed the moment. I'm going to tell you that when you witness, the enemy will attack. And sometimes the enemy will attack even through a believer. Sometimes even as believers, we can be used by the devil for things, okay? I'm not saying you're filled with the devil or anything like that. But you can be distracted by him and you listen to his prompting and he leads you astray. When you witness, the enemy will attack. The Christian journey is one of agony, folks, and it's one of exhaustion in the face of the enemy. That's what's happening when we fill up what is lacking in Christ's sufferings. Satan had a whole list of sufferings that he wanted to put Jesus through. And when Jesus finally died on the cross, breathed his last breath and said, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit, Satan was done with his work. He wasn't done with his attacks. And now he carries out the sufferings of Jesus in those in whom Jesus lives. So we suffer because we continue the work of Jesus. And we suffer because we still are recipients of the devil's attack on our lives. We have a job to do. The church still has a job to do. But never forget that we are at war. The devil is crafty. He's still attacking. He He's still attacking Jesus. But now Jesus is in me. Look at verse 29 again. Paul says, "For this purpose I also labor, striving according to his work, which he works in me in power." Do you see those words at the end of the verse? His work in me with his power. It's not my power. It's not my work. It's not my mission. It's his mission being fulfilled in me. His work in me in power. Understand that the devil's strategy is to create doubt. Did God really say? It's to create deceit, because he's a liar and he can speak no truth. It's to create discouragement among the body of Christ. That's why time and time and time and time again, the Bible tells us to not be discouraged, and the Bible tells us to be encouragers one to another. And Satan's tactic is to bring division within the body of Christ. Don't despair. Don't despair. We have a job to do. It's his work, his power in us. Why do we exist as a church? To complete the work of Jesus Christ. Although Jesus has done everything necessary to provide salvation for sinners, salvation for me, salvation for you, there's one thing left to do, and it's to carry the news of what Jesus has done to people who have never, ever heard the message. And Satan doesn't like it. And that involves much suffering. Pray with me. Father God, I thank you for your word, and I thank you for the command of your word. And I realize, Lord, that there is absolutely nothing missing or lacking from the work of Jesus Christ on the cross. It's beautiful, it's wonderful, it's complete, it's perfect. And it makes us holy. Not that we deserve it, but you give to us your holiness, your righteousness. We're saved by God's grace through our faith, and not as a result of anything we do. It's your work within us in power, and we thank you for that. And God, in the times that we struggle, that we're under the enemy's attack, that we experience suffering, that we experience weariness, remind us, you are a powerful God. You're a wonderful Father. You're a caring Lord, and you are with us. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Please remain seated for this ministry and music special song.
Ever what was on the mind of the Maker when he turned all our sorrows into fields of grace? Right here in the middle of earth and heaven, caught between the romance and the pain. Can't you see that he must have known about the heartbreak long before us? He must have known about the mistakes. Still, it chose us. Planted the tree, would he would die. Put thorns down the vine. Then he wore them. Love is the blood red stain. The beauty that the pain exposes. Maybe that's why God made roses. God is in the whisper if you listen closely. Winter means that spring is just a breath away. So don't go any faster than this very moment. Sing a hallelujah in the pouring rain. Can't you see that he must must have known about the heartbreak long before us. He must have known about the mistakes, but still he chose us. Planted the tree where he would die, put thorns down the vine. Then he wore them. Love is the blood red stain, the beauty that the pain exposes. Maybe that's why God made roses. God made roses. And just like petals falling to the ground, we fall into the one whose resurrection's here and now. All things made new, and just like petals falling to the ground, we fall into the one whose resurrection's here and now. All things made new. He must have known about the heartbreak long before us. He must have known about the mistakes, but still he chose us. Planted the tree where he would die, put thorns down the vine. Then he wore them. Love is the blood red stain, the beauty that the pain exposes. Maybe that's why God made roses. Ooh, God made roses.
Let me close this in prayer. Father God, I'm so thankful for your perfect and complete gift on the cross. Father, I pray that I serve and I'm your steward, and I go out and I just proclaim the good news of the gospel. Father, continue to encourage me each day as I'm on my knees in prayer, as I study your word. Encourage me. Give me that strength to boldly go out. I ask this not only for me, but for all in this church and all Christians, that we act in faith, that we go as you have commanded, that we listen and we do. And we pray this in the name of our Father, Yahweh. Amen.